Good morning, students. Welcome back to this decision and analysis of algorithm class. In the last class, we discussed about divide and conquer problem strategy. In that, we discussed about merge sort, that is, given a list of numbers, how to arrange them in a sorted order using the merge sort. Before that, we discussed about given a list of numbers, how to find the biggest and the smallest numbers using the divide and conquer strategy. Even before that, given a list of numbers, how to search for a given particular value using the binary search method. In all these things, we find that this binary search method, this divide and conquer method is more efficient than the conventional methods. It reduces the number of comparisons, it reduces the number of searches. In this class, we are going to discuss about quick sort. It is yet another sorting problem. The given list of numbers will be arranged in a sorted order using this dividend, using this quick sort method. The method goes like this. What is this quick sort technique? The idea is very simple. You are given some n number of different values. You have to arrange them in a sorted order. For that, what we do is we take any random numbers, random number from the given list of numbers. Okay. Usually, we take the first number of the given list of numbers as the random number. Okay. Then I call that number as a pivot number. The pivot number is compared with the remaining numbers. Simplest, let us take, you are given some 10 numbers and they are all available or they are all stored in an array, let us call it RNA. Then from the array, you take the first element, you call it as the pivot element. You compare that pivot element with the remaining numbers in that array. If the second number is less than the pivot value, that is pushed in front of the pivot value. If the third number is pushed, is less than the pivot value, that is pushed in front of the pivot value. If the fourth number is greater than the pivot value, it is not disturbed. If the fifth number is greater than the pivot value, it is not disturbed. If the sixth number in the array is less than the pivot value, that is pushed in front of the pivot value. Like this, you do it for the remaining numbers. Now, at the end of this one iteration, what happens is, numbers that are less than the pivot value are in front of it. Numbers that are greater than the pivot value are behind it. And what is to be understood is, the pivot value will be in the right location after sorting those values. That is the beauty of this one. Okay. Now, the problem is not yet over. There might be several numbers before the pivot values. There might be several numbers behind the pivot value. Now, from the numbers in front of the pivot value, you take another pivot value, you call it as P2, another pivot value P2. Then what you did for the given original problem, you do it for the numbers in front of the first pivot value. That is, those values less than the pivot P2, current P2, the pivot P2, are pushed in front of P2. Those values that are greater than the current pivot P2 are pushed back of P2. Now, the P2 will be in the right location after sorting those elements. Mind that P2 is in the right location, but the values before the P2 are not sorted. Values greater than P2 that are behind the P2 are not sorted, but all of them are less than the first pivot value P1. Now, you repeat the problem, repeat this method for values in front of the pivot value P2 and for values that are behind of pivot value P2. Like this, you keep on doing this one. At one stage, values in front of the first pivot value P1 will become sorted out. Now, repeat the same thing for values that are behind the first pivot value P1. Okay, from those values you take a new pivot value P2, then those values that are less than P2 are pushed in front of it, values greater than P2 are pushed back of it. Now the new P2 will be in the right location, but all values that are in front of P2 and behind of P2, they are all less than, greater than the first pivot value P1. That is how you repeat this process. At one stage, all the elements will become sorted. All the elements will become sorted. The idea is to partition the given values into two segments. One segment having less than the pivot values. The another segment is having values greater than the pivot value. This partition is repeated for the sub problems. Then at one stage, all the elements will become sorted. Now, how this method of solution fits into divide and conquer strategy? Initially, you are given some 10 values. That is divided into two portions, and first portion becomes less than the given original problem. Second portion is less than the given original problem. Okay. At the end of first partition, you find your value in the right location. Then you repeat the problem for the first sub problem. You divide it again, keep on dividing. Then until all the elements in front of the all the elements of the first sub problem are sorted, then you repeat those things for second sub problem, or they also will become sorted. So this method of solution fits into the divide and conquer strategy. Now look at this problem definition. Given a list of n numbers stored in an array in random order, arrange them in sorted order by recursively choosing a partition value, that is pivot value, from the given n numbers and separate the numbers into less than and greater than the partition value, that is the pivot value. By doing this, you will get the numbers sorted. How we are going to achieve this one? For the given n numbers in the array, choose one value, call it as a partition value or pivot value. Separate the numbers such that values less than the partition are pushed in front of it, and the values greater than the partition are pushed back of it. That is, the given problem P is divided into subproblems P1 and P2. The elements of P1 are less than the partition value, and the elements of P2 are greater than the partition value. and the partition value is in the right location of the sorted sequence of numbers. This procedure is repeated for numbers in problem P1 and P2. That is, whatever you did for the given problem P, that you will repeat it for the problem subproblem P1, you will repeat it for the subproblem P2 until all the elements of the subproblem P1 are sorted, all the elements of the subproblem P2 are sorted. So this is the way we are approaching this problem. Now let us try to implement this solution method in the form of an algorithm. Now this is the original algorithm quicksort, and the values are available in the array A, from the index P to the index Q. The values are available from the index P to the Q in the array A. If P is less than Q, that is, if the index P is less than the index Q, what you do? J is equal to partition of given array A comma P comma Q plus 1. So a call is given to the function partition, and the coding for the partition is given here. The coding is given here that we will trace out in a few minutes. Okay. Now this algorithm is called out here. At the end of this algorithm, you will get a return value J. That is, the pivot value is stored in the index J. That is, the value available in A of J is in the right location of the sorted sequence of numbers. Now, the problem is not yet over. You have to repeat what we did for the subproblem quicksort P2 J minus 1, quicksort J plus 1 to Q. P to J minus 1, J plus 1 to Q. You have to repeat those things. Okay. So by repeatedly calling recursive calling, we will see whether we will see that the entire elements become sorted order. Now, can we check whether this algorithm follows our control abstraction for divide and conquer? In the control abstraction for divide and conquer, there will be a condition check that checks whether the problem is simple enough so that the answer can be found straight away or not. And there will be a recursive function. Here, you are checking one condition: if P is less than Q, that is, if P is greater than Q, you don't do these things. And if P is equal to Q, then the problem is so simple that the answer can be found straight away. Otherwise, then only you go for P is equal to P less than Q. If P less than Q, then there is a recursive call, and the values are, the outputs of these recursive calls are used combined to get the solution of the given original problem. Now, we go for the algorithm partition. So there is a call for this partition algorithm here. J is equal to partition of A comma P comma Q plus 1. Now, what does this heading of this algorithm says? You are given array A in which the values are available from the index location M to the index location P. That is, values, a list of numbers are available in the array from A of M to A of P. Now, I use one variable V is equal to A of M. Set the value of M to the variable I, the value of P to the variable J. Then I use a repeat until loop. Repeat starts here and ends here. Within this repeat until loop, I have two repeat until loops. One is here, then another is here. Okay, then I will be using a condition to interchange two values. Okay. Now, let us trace out this partition algorithm in the, with an example. Now, you see here, you are given values, 9 values, and they are available in the array A from index location 1 to 9. Index location 1 is having 65, 2 is having 70, then 75, 80, 85, 60, 55, 50, 45. And for convenience sake, I have only a big value infinity in the index location 10. Okay. Now, for this example, let us trace out our partition algorithm and check how this partition algorithm put the pivot value in the right location. Okay. Algorithm partition A of M comma P. Now, I have a variable V, that is A of M. Here, what is the value of M? A of M is equal to 1. Then what is the value of P? P is equal to 10. Because the index values are available from 1 to 10. 1 to 10. So, the value of M is equal to 1. The value of P is equal to 10. V is equal to A of M. Since M is equal to 1, A of 1. What is the value available in A of 1? 65 is the value available in A of 1. So, V is equal to 65. Then, the value of M is given to a variable I. I is equal to, already M is equal to 1. M is equal to 1. And so, the value of I becomes 1. Similarly, JP is equal to 10. So, J is equal to 10. Okay. The value of P is given to J. So, J is equal to 10. I is equal to 1. With that understanding, let us trace out this repeat until loop. Now, repeat I is equal to I plus 1. I is equal to 1. So, I is equal to I plus 1 means I becomes 2. I becomes 2. Okay. Then, repeat until A of I greater than or equal to V. Now, what is the meaning of this repeat until loop? The repeat until loop is repeatedly executed as long as the Boolean condition is false. Once the Boolean condition becomes true, the loop is terminated. Now, the value of I is equal to 2. What is A of 2? A of 2 is 70. A of 2 is 70. What is the value of V? V is equal to 65. This 70 is greater than V. So the condition becomes true. So the repeat until terminates. Just now I told you that the loop is repeatedly executed as long as the Boolean condition is false. Once the Boolean condition becomes true, the loop is terminated. Now the Boolean condition has become true. So the loop is terminated. Okay, so when it terminates, the value of I is equal to 2. Next, this repeat until. Repeat, J is equal to J minus 1. What is the value of J? J is equal to 10. So, 10 minus 1, 9. Now, J is equal to 9. Until, what is A of 9? A of 9 is 45. Does 45 less than or equal to V? What is the value of V? 65. So, 45 is less than 65. The condition is true. So, the loop is terminated. This loop also gets terminated. What is the next statement? If I less than J, what's the value of J? What's the value of I? The value of I is equal to 2. The value of J is equal to 9. Now, 2 is less than 9. The condition is true. So, interchange A of I with A of J. What is A of 2? Interchange A of 2 with A of 9. A of 2 is 70. A of 9 is 45. you bring this 45 here, you bring this 75 here, that I write it now. So it is 45 and 45 and here become 9 becomes 70. And the remaining values are left as it is. So this is 65 only. This is 75 only. And this is 80 only. And this is 85 only, and this is 60 only, and this is 55. It is 55, and this is 50. Okay. Okay, now integer is executed. Now this is over. Okay, next, what is the next statement? Until I becomes greater than j, what is the value of I? I is equal to 2, j is equal to 9. Thus 2 is greater than 9. No, it is a repeat until loop. The condition is false. The loop is repeated again. Now, when it is repeated again, there is another another repeat until loop. Repeat, I is equal to I plus 1. Current value of I is equal to 2. I is incremented by 1. So, I becomes 3. What is A of 3? A of 3 is 75. Does 75 greater than 65? Yes, it is true. The condition becomes true. The loop is terminated. Then here comes another repeat until loop. J is equal to J minus 1. Current value of J is equal to 9. J is equal to J minus 1 means it becomes 8. Then A of 8. What is A of 8? 50. So this 50 is less than 65. Yes, it is so. So this condition becomes true, so it is also terminated. So the current value of I is equal to 3. The current value of J is equal to 8. 3 is less than 8. So interchange A of 3 with A of 8. This is A of 3 and this is A of 8. So this is, this should come here, this should come here. So this I make it as 50 and this I make it as 75. This is 75 and the remaining elements are as they are, that is 65 and this is 45 and this is 80 and this is 85 and this is 60 and this is 55 and this is 70. Okay, now you see this is over. Until I becomes greater than J, what is the current value of I? 3. Current value of J? 8. The condition is false. Does 3 is greater than 8? No. The loop is repeated again. Now I becomes I plus 1. I becomes 4. I becomes I is equal to I plus 1. I becomes 4. Does what is AIF4? AIF4 is 80. Does 80 is greater than 65? Yes, the condition fail. Condition becomes true, the loop terminates. Repeat J is equal to J minus 1, it becomes 7. So AIF7, that is 55. Does 55 less than 65? Yes, condition is true. It is also terminates. 4 is less than 7. So exchange them. Interchange AIF4 with AIF7. AIF4 is 80, AIF7 is 55. So in the place of 80, 55 should come. In the place of 55, it should come. So I make this one as 80. And I make this one as 55. And the remaining values are as they are. That is 65, 45, 50, 85, 60, 75, 70. Now you see, now you see the current value of I is equal to 4, current value of J is equal to 7. Does 4 is greater than 7? No. Still it is false only. You repeat this again. Repeat, I becomes incremented 5, J becomes AIF 5. What is value of AIF 5? AIF 5 is 85. 85 is greater than 65. Condition becomes true, terminated. Then J is equal to J minus 1. So current value of J is equal to 7, it becomes 6. Then what is AIF 6? AIF 6 is 60. Does 60 less than 65? Yes, condition is true, it is also terminated. Does I less than J? 5 is less than 6. So it is changed. So 5 and 6 are, AIF 5 and AIF 6 are interchanged. So so this becomes 60 and this becomes 85. Remaining values are as they are: 65, 45, 50, 55, 80, 75, 70. Now, what's the value of J? J is equal to 5. I is equal to 5. J is equal to 6. Does 5 is greater than 6? No. So, loop repeats. Now, repeat I is equal to I plus 1. I becomes 5 plus 1, 6. What is AIF 6? AIF 6 is 60. Does 60 greater than 65? No. Does 60 greater than 65? No. Condition fails. So loop is repeated. I becomes 7. What is 7? I become 7. AIF 7. AIF 7 is... I missed out one thing. Previously it was 6, AIF 6, 85. This 85 is the, this should not have come. See, repeated, AIF becomes AIF 6. What is AIF 6? AIF 6 is 85. Does 85 greater than 65? Yes. So condition terminates. Then repeat, J is equal to J minus 1. So from 6 it becomes 5. What is AIF 5? AIF 5 is 60. Does 60 less than 65? Does 60 less than the 65? Yes. Condition becomes true. So this is also terminator. Thus I is less than j, that is value of I is equal to 6, value of j is equal to 5. Does 6 is less than 5? No, no interchange happens. So next condition, until I becomes greater than j, I is 6, j is 5. Okay, so 6 is greater than 5. So condition becomes true, this outer repeat until loop is terminated. Now we come for here, a of m, the value of m is equal to 1 only. So a of 1 is equal to a of j, what's the value of j? J is equal to 5. So a of 1 is equal to a of 5. A of 1 here is equal to a of j, that is, this a of j is equal to, that is a of 5 is equal to 60, that 60 is coming here, and a of j is equal to v is equal to 65, that is a of 5 is equal to 65. A of 5 is equal to 65. Remaining values are as they are, 45, 55, 80, 75, 70. Now look at this. Our pivot value is 65. Partition value is 65. Partition value, this 65 is available in the index location 5. Look at the values before that partition value, 55, 50, 45, 60. They are all less than 65. Look at the values here, 85, 80, 75, 70. They are all bigger than the partition value 65. Now this 65 is in the right location. After sorting all these values, we will find that this 65 is in the right location. That is the beauty of this one. So this partition has successfully placed the partition value in the right location of the sorted sequence. Still this problem, the values before 65, they are not sorted. Now the problem has reduced in size from this much size to this much size. It was this much size, now it has come down to this much size. Whatever you did for this one, you did for this. At one stage, you will get all these things sorted. Then similarly, you will do it for the values here. Okay, whatever you did for the given original problem, you do it here. They too will become sorted. Then the entire numbers will become sorted. That is the idea of this one. That is the idea behind this one. See, what is a quick sort? P comma j minus 1. Then P quick sort j plus 1 comma q. Okay. That's how you do it. Let us see in the next class. Thank you.